other speakers for their lengthy introduction. It saves me a lot of work. I'm honored to this day, so I decided to change my original plan and try to put the work that I have been doing with my partners in a perspective. And I got the idea last week when I walked in London in the Science Museum, where they had a shopping window, a pseudo shopping window, that was to wake up the public that lots of everyday goods are actually the outcome of military developments. And here you see in the background a quick photograph I made, that there's a lot of research going on that is not at all meant for the benefit of people, but it's actually meant to destroy people, and then later it turns out to be much more useful in a different way. And this is also a point in case. The background of the work that we are doing is, of course, the global computing, the World Wide Web. Now, the first World Wide Web really is air traffic. And air traffic is a byproduct of strategic bombing in World War II. So these exotic trips to Thailand and hell knows where are actually based on an idea that developed to bomb Germany. So from this to this. A second thing is that World War II didn't end in 1945. It continued till the 1990s, as we're now celebrating these days with the fall of the Berlin Wall. Microcomputers that we are now using everywhere are actually the byproduct of guided missiles. And they put one on a couple on the moon to show that they could also land them on the Red Square. And then finally, the people who invented these draconian ideas also thought that it might hit themselves, so they worked out a system to evade being hit themselves. And that is what first was the ARPANET and what eventually produced the internet. So in three easy lessons, so you see a centralized network that can be wiped out with one hit, a decentralized one, and a distributed network. And of course, the internet is a case of a distributed network. The early Usenet carefully skimmed all the communist countries, as you can see on this map, but today everybody's included. It's a big worldwide system. But it had a tremendous impact on the thinking of computer architecture. Like in air traffic, if you don't speak English, you don't fly. As a passenger, you can fly with any language, but the pilots all communicate in English. And when computing emerged, it was assumed that if you cannot handle English, you don't count in computing. And on top of that, the encoding of text was considered the trade secret, so the various computer companies kept the encoding structures that they used to themselves, and there was an enormous amount of infighting necessary, mainly between American companies, to agree on the American standard code for information interchange. And in this whole development, other languages were irrelevant. They were problems. And so that is the background, and this attitude lasts to this day. I'm going to give some examples of that. But it's also the background against oddball individuals emerge, and I can't name them all, but I want to name two of them because they have relevance on the development of Arabic computing, which has two sides, encoding, and on the other hand, typography, the invisible and the visible side of computing. In the 1970s, there was a man called Pierre Mackay. His name is never quoted, but he's a classic scholar. He is now, of course, emeritus from the University of Washington in Seattle. He is a multidiscipline academic. He works with with engineers, but also with calligraphers. He went to Istanbul to figure out how Arabic works. In the 1980s, we have another man, Joseph Becker. He is an industrial researcher with Xerox, Frank Xerox, where he worked there at the time, on multilingual systems. And he is a pragmatic man. He wants solutions that work. And I mentioned these two people because they are, in a way, role models for the two approaches yet that you can take in multilingual computing, and particularly regarding Arabic. Pierre Mackay went to Istanbul, got to know calligraphers, and learned how the script worked, analyzed it in pen strokes. That was way before we did it, and also I didn't know about this until later when we were into the project. And he did that with a company in Kiel, with the HEL Digiset system. And he published about this. And in the 1980s, in fact, in 1984, another man drew my attention, and that was Joseph Becker. And Joe Becker wrote an article in the Scientific American about multilingual computing, which I found fascinating, but on the other hand, slightly appalling, because it had a strongly simplified presentation of what Arabic looks like, and of course the comment that it is complicated. You always hear people call Arabic complicated who have a very simplified idea of it. What makes Joe Becker important and interesting is that he is the co-founder of the Unicode Consortium. And in fact, he did it to this day, Mark Davis is the president of the Unicode Consortium, and together they played a role, certainly Mark Davis, in producing the first Arabic system for the Apple. And it was all based on the kind of concept that Joe Becker describes in his 1984 article. It's a very strongly simplified view of Arabic. I'm trying to sketch the background against which we started to get interested, and that's initially me as an academic, and later my partners whom I drew into this. The internet expands very slowly in the 1980s. Computers are mainly standalone glorified typewriters, and there is no concept of multilingual computing. You have bilingual computing at best. There were some oddball programs like Multilingual Scholar, but they had their own private coding and were very much glorified typewriters. In these days, important development to to bring the microcomputer to the general public was pioneered by Apple computers. It was considered an enormous threat to companies like IBM, who aggressively reacted by making a mock-up computer, a shoebox with electronics, and published the specs so that everybody could make a copy. Mainly, this was taken up in Taiwan to eliminate the threat that this little microcomputer was posing to the big industry. In a later stage, Apple introduces the famous Macintosh with a Windows-based interface, a user interface where you can point and click. And Microsoft had hired a small company to wreck an existing operating system so that it could fit in the shoebox. And this small company escaped out of the bottle and is now known as Microsoft. It's an accidental side effect of the IBM campaign, because they hadn't completely secured the rights to the PC-DOS operating system. And this company started mimicking Windows, and of course call it what it is, Windows. Well, in this background, I was more or less oblivious of all this. I was a student of Slavic languages. This is a photograph of me in a Macedonian newspaper taken in 1971. And sometimes I was engaged in educational policies. This is on the Dutch Binnenhof, where protesters who want to hit the bullseye go to protest, in this case a guy against raising the cost of study. And here I got involved in the political organization of Moroccans and Turks in the Netherlands, and I'm here breaking in together with a Turkish friend in a Dutch meeting that was discussing the interests of foreigners in the Netherlands without inviting them. In this context, I got interested for two reasons in Turkish. The first reason is that if you study Russian and you have to read books, it turns out that there are much more interesting books, in my view, than the literature. That's the waver-thin monographs about languages of Central Asia that you can only read if you know Russian. In other words, instead of War and Peace and the Brothers Karamazov and all these huge books, I was much more enthused by the waver-thin, as I said, publications about totally new subjects and that opened new perspectives. When I consequently moved to the Department of Middle Eastern Studies to study Turkish, they told me that I had to come back with Arabic. And this enraged me to the extent that I did it, and I was back in a couple of months. And in the process, I also learned to write Arabic. And the interesting thing is that this is my handwriting. I think I was a couple of weeks into Arabic there. and I did it not from practice following a calligraphy teacher and endlessly repeating. I actually did it from a book that I was told to use from theory. And it's a book by T.F. Mitchell. It's called, let me back this up for a sec. It's called The Writing Arabic, Introduction to the Rukah Writing System. And the main, its force is that it presents the Arabic writing system as a structure instead as of a set of intuitive behaviors. Of course it isn't, because you cannot have a writing system that functions between millions of people over hundreds of years if it's not structured. So a grammar is actually a very logical thing for a writing system. And before long I found myself writing Arabic texts on posters for Moroccans in the Netherlands. This was in 75, so this is way before I got interested in computing. It's not particularly nice calligraphy, but what's interesting about it, even now, and anybody who is familiar with Arabic script can see that it is grammatically correct. It doesn't make any of these compromises that you find in what was described as complex Arabic by people who use actually simplified Arabic. This is fully blown Arabic. Not long after that, I decided that I traveled a lot, mainly hitchhiking, until I got a ride from a person who was my age and was driving big trucks, returning from a trip to Pakistan. I discovered that there were two companies driving between Europe and Pakistan. There was one English and one Dutch company in the old 17th century tradition. They were discovering the land roads, and I thought that I wanted to belong to them, and I joined the company. So I spent a while in Saudi Arabia, among others, discovering roads. Later, I took the opportunity again to avoid being a tourist in the Middle East. I joined the Dutch army for a while as as a military interpreter in the peacekeeping operation in South Lebanon. And in that context, I was asked to write the grammar, a handbook of the Arabic language for the soldiers. And I made it a point that it should also be executed with the correct script. And that's where I discovered that even with a budget, I could not get the script that you need to write Arabic. I could only get Linotype, all kinds of photo settings solutions. But look at this Jeep. This is a Land Rover. It's driven by the liaison officer of the Lebanese army. It's written on it. I've enhanced it a bit in the styles of the day. You saw these scripts everywhere, even on trucks, everywhere on the walls, on casual, formal. This is the top one is the so-called Nasr style. The bottom one is the so-called Nastaliq style. And you see on the truck, it's just a casual bit of lettering. And this is what I wanted in the book. And then a wonderful solution appeared in this form. Miriam Somers, who is actually a student of Chris Brandt, whose name was mentioned earlier today, an interior architect, a carpenter, and a typographer. And together, here you see some of her lettering exercises that she did for Chris Brandt. Actually, Chris Brandt kept the best ones for his own collection, so these are the ones that were left over. And in the discussions, we got the idea to make a wooden model of Arabic. With her skills as a carpenter, we made a wooden model of Arabic to clip the letters together, where I contributed a kind of wooden computer program in the form of stubs and holes to prevent or allow the connecting of letters according to the rules, the basic rules. In other words, we made a model of simplified Arabic. And this is around the time that we discovered that it was elegant, but at the same time, here you see in a flash the zeros and the ones that were actually built in it as wooden stubs. The prints, we used these prints, we put them on a photocopier and removed the connecting lines that you could see from the blocks. The resulting script was appalling. This was not what I wanted to use. This is not Arabic. It is not what I wanted. Here is an image of the kind of stuff that we make today. To the layman, it may look identical, but there are huge differences. In one is naive and the other one is accomplished. The basic thing is that we really didn't know how the script worked. Each time we found a little detail in the real script that we didn't cover, but we had no guideline and no clue how to solve this. And so we abandoned it. We went back to the drawing table, and I discovered another idea that Miriam had developed, also under the guidance of Chris Brandt, and that's an exercise into the Chinese script, which, of course, in true carpenter style, crystallized into a wooden block, a massive block of wood that could be taken together and clipped together again. This is a pen stroke. This is a model of a pen stroke system. And that we applied on the Ruka script. And here you see the whole set, 70 glyphs, that we were able to summarize the whole Ruka script in. And how was that possible? Well, remember the grammar that taught me to write in a couple of weeks. It was a description of the writing system that had all the information that is necessary. So here are some drawings. I hope you can see on the screen that these are highly professional architectural drafts. And it gave us another idea. You may have gathered that I am a bit of a subversive mind. Here you see what I would call today a letter grenade or text grenade. It is, this is a special one. I remember the Institute for Slavic Studies had a typewriter with two keyboards and one carriage and a big switch that you could use let me hold this much easier. A little switch which you could raise the carriage and slam it into the next block, so that you could have two sets of keys to work on the same text. And this was done when extra characters, and the people of Brill know what I'm talking about, when you have a Slavic language and you all of a sudden need a strange diacritic marks added into the text, they could lift the carriage and bring it into in front of the other keyboard, type a couple of words and move it back again. One generation later, the same concept was miniaturized in the form of the text grenade. You could simply clip the golf ball in the machine and take it out again. But what you see here is a special one that was modified by order of the Institute for Oriental Studies in Amsterdam, where there is a lowered dot in a non-moving position, and there is also a half ring left, half ring right, and a superscript macron, also in a overstrike position. How does it end up here? Well, there is a little detail here. A tooth broke off, and so here at the bottom you can see one of the teeth here that make it work on the machine had broken off, and the secretary of the institute had thrown it into the dustbin. I was there when it happened, and I waited for my chance. I took it out of the dustbin, called one of my Turkish friends who worked with the IBM factory in Amsterdam, and said, "Don't you have another one that I can cannibalize?" So here on the left you see one. I broke off the teeth to repair it, and I used optician-style bolts and nuts to fix all the other parts that had come off. And I've been using this ever since, until the arrival of multilingual computer. This, the company that made the modifications, I tracked, and we asked them to make modifications on a daisy wheel printer, so that the concept that I just described of the decomposition of the Ruka script into basic elements could actually be executed on a daisy wheel printer. And here you see the result. We did only one letter, but we needed only one letter because it was a matter of proof of concept. And the programming that is necessary to do this, it was run from an early Z80 computer with a special interface. We could make negative and positive vertical and horizontal increments, unlike in a normal typewriter. So it was already something very much virtualized. And here comes another sidebar to this project. This is Peter Somers, our other partner, who is an aeronautical engineer and a specialist in image analysis. For instance, here is a speckle interferometer that was used in the checking of aeroplanes for potential defects without having to wreck them, the non-destructive testing. He wrote the code to control this thing, this machine, and here you see some original imprints. And to give you an idea when this all happened, all of this delicate work, it happened in the days that the first Macintosh arrived. And you see, this is a Macintosh with Arabic on it, way before anybody was thinking of doing it. And this is another software project to put the whole thing in the proper time frame. And here is the latest versions of both of them with the latest Mac. So that's, we have spent some time getting this off the ground. But in 1986 already, we could produce, let me back up, this is for the Leiden City Council. It's a parallel text of Latin, Dutch, and Arabic, where all the Arabic is in Ruka. And the Ruka has even alternative forms. If you follow my you can see the cursor, I hope. Yep. You can see here the word Shikayet, where there is a tucked in Kaf Alif. And there is here the word Shikayet, where the Kaf Alif is not tucked in. We could do the same thing in different forms already. So many of the ideas that we have later worked out into Tasmim were already 1986 ready. So why did we do Ruka? Well, I already hinted at it. There was a grammar for it. So the idea of intelligent fonts, or smart fonts, or intelligent typography, call it what you will, doesn't really make sense without knowledge. Intelligence without knowledge is like an unguided missile. There's a lot of effort to make intelligent and smart font technology, and that's the whole problem with OpenType. It starts from the wrong end, and I said I was not going to talk about it, but it is a bit like the tail wagging the dog. An enormous effort to get the technology there, but there's very little research into the script, and we more or less accidentally stumbled into this field of Arabic script by our. There was a very nice formula for it. I'm sure John remembers, but it's a. Anyway, we used Mitchell. Mitchell is another name that I want to mention. We have Mackay, who made the analysis of pen strokes. And there is Mitchell, who made an exhaustive analysis of the writing system. And interestingly, the Orientalists are totally absent in this field. Mackay is a professor of classical languages, Latin and Greek. Who got bored with Latin and Greek. I had a long phone call with him a few days ago. I'd never met him. I finally managed to trace him, and I wanted to honor him also today in his talk.
And he said, I got bored with Latin and Greek, and I said, well, according to the dictionary, Arabic is also classic, so he was allowed to teach classical Arabic as well. And in this context, he got involved with what is later became the Tech Group. He closely worked with Donald Knuth, so he's really one of the, also one of the fine founding minds in this whole business. So now, here is maybe a claim that in a sense is maybe over the top, because people were already doing thinking in terms of adding intelligence to typography. And I think our claim to fame is that we managed to push it again a couple of steps further by bringing real understanding of how a script works together with good design, real professional artistic design, and real professional programming. And only one letter, but this one letter, the letter meme, repeated many times, ends up to give you the conditions for an Arabic phrase that has the right harmony or the right swing, call it what you will. Arabic is more than a plain linear script. There is a certain cadence in it. In fact, there are so-called cascading letters that require a top-to-bottom connection. And if you can't handle them, you don't have it. You don't have the technology for the script. Here you see our first presentation to the world in London in 1989 in a famous exhibition in the Zamana Gallery, Islamic Calligraphy. We offered to translate and print all the captions in Arabic with the Ruqa system. And here you see a piece of computer-generated stuff, and this is the original that we emulate. Of course, it's hard to see for you to really appreciate all the details, but I hope you understand that for the 1980s we got the gist of this of the writing system. This was discovered by Microsoft, and I think that's an important point. It was seen already in late 1980s, and in the early 1990s, Microsoft asked us to turn this into an Olay server. And you have to, again, to understand the context. We provide for all the Middle Eastern editions of Microsoft Office a utility that has intelligence regarding Arabic script. In a time that Microsoft wasn't on the internet, there was no Microsoft internet address. In fact, the man with whom I was corresponding about this had to take a CompuServe account to exchange data. That is where we were. And Microsoft was very much in the mindset of if you don't know English, the one that I started with, you're basically not in computing. And they consider this a huge favor to have a small team working on Arabic stuff, the MEPD, Microsoft Middle East Product Development Team. I happily worked with them for many years, and therefore I know that only in the second half of the 1990s, Microsoft decided to take the internet serious when they saw the Netscape threat, and they're one of the latest members of the Unicode Consortium. With my company, I've been a member since 1992 or 1993, and so I've seen this whole development. And you can imagine that when Microsoft joined the Unicode Consortium and saw the reality of global computing, only then they realized that they had to deal with a new kind of typography. So you can no longer digitize typography. You have to have computer typography. That's a totally different thing, and that is typography to handle the multitude of scripts and data systems. And of course, that's why I thank the previous speakers for introducing the topic. Let me try to speed this up so that I don't miss my own award ceremony. we brought it to fruition recently. Together with, I must, by the way, I said some highly critical things of Microsoft in the beginning, but I have to be grateful, because they were the only company who saw what we did and invited us to join their team and gave us a worldwide recognition for the work. So, I mean, there is always a plus and a minus to things. What we did in a nutshell to visualize it is that we see Arabic as a script that is driven by fusions, the letters merge. That's referring to an earlier idea that Arabic would have ligatures. what is happening is that the letters blend together into single units. And that's symbolized in this image by the golden outline. This is the unit of typography. This is where the kerning happens. This is where where the mechanism is mainly dealing with, what the mechanism is dealing with. But at the same time, I gave the provocative colors to this image. Of course, these are the Google colors. They symbolize the searchability of and the data structure. So each grapheme is colored individually. But in reality, of course, the text is black. But it is possible to do this. And another thing is that this is one particular style, but this, in the same style, you can also revert certain things. For instance, there is a yellow and a green letter that are both the letters meme. After this is the word tasmim with two M's. And in the first image, one the yellow meme is closed and the green one is open. In the second image, this is reverted. The first is open and the second is closed. It changes the whole merger, the whole fusion changes. You can do this again by closing both of the memes. And so I have here three examples. These are not the normal, there's a lot of talk about Arabic, and certainly after 9/11, the interest in Arabic has tremendously increased. And everybody knows that Arabic has initial, middle, final, and isolated forms. And that is what I call simplified Arabic. That is a very, very unrealistic concept. You can only say there is an initial, middle, final, and isolated position, and which form it takes is at least determined by the following and the preceding letter, and there is also an amount of free variation, and that's the one that the aspect that I'm showing in this particular image. Here is an image of what typically would be seen in the Persian approach to calligraphy. This is again the word tasmim, but now not three, but a whole stack of possible forms for the same word and same style. And this is, of course, the texture of Arabic that makes it so hard to handle. To generate this in a way that it is aesthetically acceptable and hopefully pleasing is already not trivial, but just imagine the task of the people who want to reverse this, who make OCR, optical character recognition, for, let's say, 5 centuries of Ottoman documents that are still waiting to be deciphered. Now, I'm now shifting into another presentation that I want to put behind us. The computerizing of Arabic is actually based not on typography, but on typewriters. And this typewriter that I bought in Beirut is actually protesting against its own output. You see, let me back up. There is its name, Continental, and I'm enlarging it again, is much more elegant and dynamic than the typical output of such a machine. You see, the repetition of the same vertical stub is avoided in real Arabic, and it's only a feature of highly complex simplified Arabic. And on top of this, I graphed the keyboard of an earlier Mac computer, but the message is clear. Our computing is a direct continuation of typewriting and not of typesetting. Which is not so bad, but a typewriter could not handle the Quran, it could not handle classical literature. It had only a very limited and slightly distorted character set. On top of that, it had a highly distorted glyph set, so the shapes. You could consider this the ultimate victory of Western thinking over a very rich Middle Eastern graphic tradition that Islam prides itself on. Now, here you see the text green aid again, the IBM golf ball. It's a brilliant idea. You see two hemispheres, one for uppercase, one for lowercase, and a simple mechanism to shift. What happened to Arabic is that this concept was basically unchanged, used for Arabic. So Arabic had to change. So not the technology changed, the script was changed to fit into this concept. And now Arabic was reduced to a script with a final form and a non-final form, depending on, or and in addition now we have also an initial and a middle form, but essentially it is putting into a box something that doesn't belong there. So this kind of output instead of this kind of output, where the same style with slightly different calligraphic parameters could be elongated internally, it could be varied, it could be elongated in final position. That is a totally, now it's a different animal. And that's all gone with the typewriter. And even in the 19th century, typographers in the Middle East had already managed to move beyond this kind of quality. In fact, I'm superimposing a bit of modern simplified Arabic, which is not very different from the kind of Arabic that was produced in Europe, also with no knowledge of what I call the grammar of the script. And to understand how gross that is, I'm confronting you with an image of a Latin text that has been stripped of a key feature, the use of uppercase and lowercase. And if you get, it very quickly starts to look like Nigerian spam. It is in fact an invitation to pay tax by the US president. And of course it looks much more convincing if you improve your typography. But this is the, typography is like a way of packaging the message. And packaging the message is a very normal social thing. You don't walk into a wedding party in sports shoes and shorts. Now, here's a dramatic example of how bad this can get if you do not have understand that this really plays is a factor that plays. We have had earlier this year a turning point speech by Obama, President Obama of the United States, a new beginning. And on the website of the White House, it was posted in translations in all the Arabic scripted languages. And I'm starting with the Arabic one. Well, very few of you can read Arabic. I don't think it's necessary to read Arabic to understand that this is technically the most impossible and incompetent execution of a font. It's ridiculous. For all clarity, what they're trying to visualize is this. So someone didn't know how to generate a PDF. But okay, that's, you could say, well, as long as the translation is okay, there's no problem. Then here is another one. This is in the Persian one. You can see that there were some important passages, so they are underlined. But you have to realize that Persia is the country that is one of the major players in the graphic tradition of Islam. And if you want to hit a chord with them, try to go into their vibes. And if you are the president of the United States, why don't you use your seal? These are all little gestures. Someone who studies the history of diplomatic relations between Europe and the Middle East, the Ottoman Empire and the Dutch Republic, or the British Empire, you have all, these are a joy to behold. You have beautiful seals, you have the Tughra of the Ottomans, you have the Rijkswapen of the Netherlands. This is not a way to, if it's such an important message, a turning point, a new start, make sure that the people who missed the spoken edition can at least enjoy the written edition. It gets worse. Here you have the location of the speech was in Cairo, and here some of the letters that make up the word Cairo don't connect. This is the Punjabi edition. And then finally the southern Afghanistan area where they speak Pashto, among them Kandahar, what have the Uruzgan, where the Dutch forces are. If you want to win the hearts and minds of the people there, try consider using at least script that is technically enabled to deal with the orthography. Here the letters don't connect because the particular letter with the ring was not programmed to connect to the next letter. This is when I started. Apparently there's still a deep sense that they should be happy that they get anything at all. Basically we expect them to read English. And then, who am I to make this criticism? Well, I can. When you see an image like this, this is a photograph of the two presidential hopefuls during a television debate. And I was totally distracted by this image in the background. It's a Decotype font. That's always fun. So, this is the... It's marked by all these idiotic extenders at the in the final letters. It was never meant to be used like that, but it's great to see it. And then this would frighten any normal newspaper reader. But what I see is happy customers. They're all using, on the posters, not all of them, but a considerable number of them are using the Deco Diagnosc in the Microsoft edition that is very widely spread in the Middle East. And you see, the photo takes on a whole different meaning if you realize that they're pleased with the typography. And that brings me to the whole concept of graphic proficiency. This is an image, again, from a newspaper taken recently in the Swat Valley. Let me stop here for a moment. It's in Urdu, which says Hijamet Karna Mana He. It means bloodletting is prohibited. It's a kind of popular medicine to cut in the skin so that the blood runs away and it makes you healthy. It's against Islamic medicine, so the bearded men walk in and they write this text in Pakistan. And some people call this graffiti, but you could also say, well, it's very aptly written, casually written, simplified Arabic. And I'm superimposing our own model of this script, which is also simplified Arabic, but it's definitely not the kind of simplified Arabic that's being produced in Europe or in America. I have to break in for a second because it's running away on me, just a second. Where it got the idea that it should use timings, I don't know, but I never asked it. Okay, so superimposing this, compare, you see the blue and the gold are essentially the same kind of script. It's almost like two people speaking the same language, the one more casual and the other more precise, but they agree on the basic structure of the script. And it's easy to do. Even a not very educated Talib in the Swat Valley can casually write like that. He has it in his system. Whereas the kind of industrial simplifications of Arabic have no relation to that, and you will never find any casual writing in this kind of script. And this brings me to the point that, yeah, you can look at script like a grammar. After all, it's very close to language. It's the skin of language. Many people use the same protocol. And in using the protocol, there are variations. And these are, in linguistics, defined as competence versus performance. Competence is what you put in the grammar. And the actual language use, where it slightly deviates from what the grammar prescribes, is called performance, and there is a certain tolerance for variation. For instance, I can take a random piece of Persian from the internet, superimpose our own computer model. You see that it mostly coincides. There's some differences, and it's within a certain tolerance. They're both expressions of the Nastaliq style. One individualized, one generalized. Of course, as outsiders, we have made a computer model of the general system. And any Persian native or natural user would, of course, have his own notice system and at the same time has a slightly personalized take. There is one little detail that I want to add, that in some cases letters go into a certain relation that has never been described in any of the grammars that I know, but we discovered it and we added it to the system. It's actually here, you know, Persian is everywhere. This is in Germany, and I'm zooming into one particular word. Here you see the same two letters that should tuck in together, and apparently they're not tucked in together because these are two words. So theoretically, if it had been one word, they would have looked different than if they are two words. We build it like that, but basically we're guessing. We get no objections from the speaker and the writer community, but what I want to say is, to this day, 21st century, Arabic script is still uncharted territory. We're still guessing. So what's the point in having smartphone technology if you don't know what you're programming? That's in a nutshell the comment here. Now, another observation, I'm going to say a bit more about Nastaliq, which is an Eastern style. There's also a Western style and a Central style. And each of them each of these styles is connected with the history of the Middle East. Persia is a very powerful engine of Islamic culture, and it triggered the Ottoman Empire, which is the central one. And the Western development is a slightly different route directly from the Middle East without the Persian factor. And as a result, Western script looks totally different from Middle Eastern and Eastern script. And I'm giving them now together so that you can get a quick impression of how different these visual languages are. So on the left, you see North African, Maghribi, and Andalusian. In the center, the Ottoman Rukka style, which is to this day the basis of the Syrians, the handwriting of people in Iraq, Syria, Lebanon, Egypt, Saudi Arabia, they all learned to write in this style. And on the right, you see a slightly aggressive execution of the Nastaliq style by a Punjabi. Now, Nastaliq is something that I want to focus on because we made recently a Nastaliq model, and it's a good point in case of what we do. Nastaliq is a typical pre-typographic structure. It has not been contaminated by what I call typographisms. It emerged in the 14th century. It's fully functional. It has a fully functional dissimilation and assimilation system. That means that where there are short vertical stubs, there's a subtle mechanism to make them unequal. And in gray, you can see the system in the Nasr, and in black, in the Nastaliq. And you can see they're practically the same. It's just it's as if you are looking at the same object from a different perspective. And that is what it is. Nasr means copy text style, and Nastaliq means the same in cursive or hanging script. It has fully functional falling connections, you know, the cascading effect. That is a condition to make any progress into Arabic script. There is no, unlike the Nasr style, there is no tempering. This is not changing. So where technology can change Arabic and redesign it to fit onto machines that are not really designed for Arabic, with Nastaliq you really come to full stop and have to rethink everything, because without technology, Nastaliq won't work. So now you have to design a technology. One of the final aspects is that it has the letter group that makes up Allah, Lam Lam Ha, takes on a special shape if it is used for the name of God. Whereas in other words, Lale, which means out, the same letters, has a different image. Which is one of the endless nuisances of Persian users when they want to write to their auntie, and that the machine automatically creates God because of some silly decision in a different world. And this script is the living script of Iran, Afghanistan, Pakistan, and India for the Arabic scripted languages. It has strict proportions. I will not go into every detail now. There are norms, and this is an interesting one to dwell on, because these two images, either of them could end up in a fashionable coffee table book with a caption, "This is a very nice piece of Arabic calligraphy." And the interesting thing is that there is a Turkish comment, Talik hatanen gerektirdi hususiyetlerden tamamen mahrum bir besmele. Here you have an invocation of God that is completely stripped of anything that makes this style beautiful. So there are explicit opinions, this is wrong and the other one is right. And you could also guess why the positioning of the dot, naive or subtle, the use of ligatures. For instance, here is a ligature between an alif and a nun. This vertical bar is subtly placed against the final form of a previous letter. That's a ligature, by the way. And in the other script, it's missed. Oh, this is a nice one here. The guiding principles are all little animals inside the whites. And for instance, in this letter, it's a dove, the head of a bird. And you see, this is a dead bird. It's very interesting because if nobody tells you which bird is alive and which isn't, you never learn nastalik. And it's a simple, these are the little rules of the fist. And with this in the back of your mind, it's possible probably to have a firm statement, a firm opinion about this. This is nastalik. But in terms of performance, it's, I would say, at the lower end. And that is to say, it is nastalik, it's valid nastalik, but not all nastalik is perfect, and also nastalik is not by definition a calligraphic style. It's just a writing system. The high end is calligraphic, the low end is graffiti, like the Swat Valley barbarian, but it's the same script. And it's everywhere in the streets. These are Baluchi ladies protesting. With superimposed an idealized form of the same script. Here is an interesting aspect that nastalik shares with most other and certainly most later Arabic calligraphic styles, that for a certain fusion of letters there are more than one solution available. This is I'm zooming in. This is the generic ba, a meme, and two more generic ba's. And it could also have been resolved like this, where the meme, which is this but is not here, is followed by an extension, or it's stuck together. So these are two solutions. And on the same wall, a similar alternative is resolved by the calligrapher in the other way. So where this letter group could have had the tucked in solution, as I'm showing here, he chooses the open solution. In other words, these are completely free, interchangeable, and transparent artistic variations, or what you would call lateral variations. Then there is the concept of regional dialects. Well, this image serves to underscore that, excuse me, nastalik is not by definition a religious script. It can be used for anything that requires proper, nice, good writing. I'm superimposing our computer model. You can see it is different, but I take the liberty to assume that we are here within the tolerance of variation. It's both reasonable nastalik. But the green image, I can also give a different shape. And on the rightmost letter block, I've now given a short letter Ra instead of the long one of the first image. It automatically changes the first letter. So you have a free change that causes a conditional change. I've stretched and here shortened the final letter. I've imposed a miniature copy and omitted it on the lower example. And I have here also a small shape detail that changes. These are all switches in Tasmim, by the way. By doing so, I have accomplished, within the freedom of Persian, another way of doing the same thing without really changing anything. It's like the lateral change that I described. But interestingly, if you submit this to an Urdu audience, they would automatically prefer the lower one. So there are some areas that have a regional preference for certain use. The result is that the same basic writing system in effect exists in regional or language associated variants or dialects. There's a Persian, an Urdu, and there's even an Arabic version. But the Arabic one is a bit odd. I found this in a Dutch newspaper recently. It looks very impressive, but it is also intriguing because, first of all, Arabs don't give it the name Nastaliq as it is called in Persian. They call it Persian. So that's good. Then my attention is drawn by this particular letter group. It's a letter group Ha Wow. It's Hua. It's among others the name for God. The letter Ha is exactly identical as in this Ha A form. What you're seeing really is the letter Ha, first with a descending and second with an ascending letter following. So a downward and an upward move. Now the interesting thing is that there is a horizontal and a vertical Ha in this particular style. So on the left you see a vertical Ha, and on the right you see a horizontal Ha. And in fact, later scribes add an element of the vertical Ha built under it, which is now seen as a sort of a comma, to enhance legibility of these double, this extra bend, this double wobble in the script. Now, what I'm observing here is that the Arabic text here has an ungrammatical, the wrong, in other words, form for the initial Ha, which would only be acceptable in the Arabic domain, but the Persians and the Turks and the Pakistanis would reject it. And this brings me back to the initial image. Here was a letter Ha. I showed you that there is a simplified Arabic that is standard. By the way, it is the typeface that was used by the Obama communications. And the reason why I asked that later in Washington is that the government of the United States government has a standard practice of using Times New Roman for all its public relations. Now, the glitch is that there is no Arabic Times New Roman, and Microsoft had stuck in a whole bunch of Mickey Mouse glyphs as placebo. And now all the state communication to the Middle East in the strategically essential area are going out in Mickey Mouse style. And how bad it can get is this detail. Here is the letter Ha with an E following. You can see in blue and in gold that there is a little comma dangling under it. That is a confirmation sign that you're looking at a horizontal Ha, but it is a Ha. But it has two teeth and not one. If you can see that clearly. So it occurred to me, let's look in my computer which fonts can handle this and which don't. So first, the wrong and the right side by side. So half of my fonts actually had the same initial form, always the vertical initial form, whether it's horizontal or vertical. And the other half of my fonts had some awareness of this rule. So some fonts know how to do it, some don't. I have mentioned the concept of grammar a couple of times. This is a good example of knowing the grammar or not knowing the grammar. Again, there is no point in making a typeface and applying whatever amount of smartphone technology on a design if you don't know how the script works. So here you see that on the right top there are three Nastaliq fonts, including our own on top. They all know how this works. And the other ones are struggling with it or don't have a really elegant solution. And many of them don't know how to avoid a collision between the comma and the backswashing final yeah. It's problematic. In any case, grammar, if you walk into a doctor's office and to a doctor and you say to the doctor, "Me is ill," he will look at you seriously and find a way to cure you. But he would also think that this guy doesn't really speak English very well. And this is the kind of problem with grammatical errors. Grammatical errors do not necessarily impede the basic communication, but they generate noise in the communication that you sometimes want to avoid. And that is, of course, I think I also have to make it clear that I admire Obama for what he is doing, and I think that the error that he makes is typical for the Western approach to the Middle East. Proficiency is a normal thing in language use. If you speak a foreign language, you make an effort to pronounce it correctly. If you write a foreign language, you should make an effort to shape it correctly. Here's an image of Persian handwritten nastaliq. Here's an image of Pakistani handwritten nastaliq. On the left is the introduction to the Shahnameh, the document that is second or maybe first regarding the Quran in Persian tradition. It was offered to the former Shah, and Shah, you can imagine that this guy went to the limit to shape his nastaliq. It's very roomy, its horizontal and vertical spacing is brilliant. This is a lady's weekly. It's about love stories and all that. Clearly, there's not too much paper available. It must be cheap and lots of text, so it's condensed horizontally and vertically. Spacing is very tight. But essentially, it's this, and the execution in terms of proficiency, in terms of performance, is at the lower end, whereas the Persian one is at the higher end. But these are all parameters, particularly the spacing parameters and the regional variation parameters, that can all be put into a computer program. For instance, the Persians have a particular preference that I, in this image, call a high bridge connection, where there could also be a low bridge. And the red image shows what the low bridge means. It's the same word, there's nothing has changed. This is a typical example of free variation. Within Persian, both are acceptable, but if you see a low bridge example in Urdu, you can, with our system, generate a high bridge as well, but it would not really be appreciated in a Pakistani target audience. So this is a good example of regional preferences. A comment about nastaliq typography. On Wikipedia, I saw nastaliq is so complex that to this day it has defeated any attempt to automate it or to mechanize it. Well, that's not true. In the 19th century, in 1840, an Armenian typographer by the name Mohandisoglu already succeeded in doing it, and in a brilliant way. Anybody who is familiar with the image of typeset Arabic will be amazed by seeing this in 1840, or 1842. This was printed in Egypt with a design that was made in Cairo, or in Istanbul. In the same period, the main stream script system, the NAS, still looked like this. And for typographers, this is a clear image, but also those who are not familiar with typography, this is primitive. This is nothing changed since the introduction of Middle Eastern typography in the first half of the 18th century. For all clarity, the European attempts to design Arabic typography don't really count in the Middle East. And actually, a famous Dutch orientalist by the name of Thomas Arpenius commented about Grandjean's attempts to create Arabic typography that it was not very good. And interestingly, the publisher of this comment recently, in a Braille edition, makes a footnote where he says that Arpenius was very harsh. And I think that Arpenius was simply professional and on the ball. He called it what it was. And ever since, we have the idea that in European Arabic typography counts in this game, but it really doesn't. Only the Middle Eastern version does. And for instance, in the 1860s, Mohandisyan, the same man, or Mohandisoglu, finally succeeded in doing this. This was the model that triggered all the typographical developments in West and East that are worth mentioning. Took another quarter century. So nastaliq is actually simplified Arabic, otherwise Mohandisyan would have started with Nas. And now the irony is that in Western eyes, scripts like nastaliq are routinely categorized as complex script with an implicit or an explicit message, simplify it. And I'm reminding you of the basic attitude, if you can't speak English, you can't fly. Or for the users in the Middle East themselves, it's a practical and an elegant writing system, and there's no need to destroy it. Keep it intact. And that's, in fact, a major effort is going on in Iran and Pakistan to design open type fonts that you see the green one is an Iranian project, the black one on the left is ours, and the differences are minute, is for connoisseurs to discover. There is a Pakistani development, but interestingly, it doesn't have this particular subtle tucking in of the two letters, and therefore the Pakistani development is not, cannot be used in Iran. You can try to use it, but it will be mocked. It's unfit for Persian. And vice versa, a project in Pakistan that uses OpenType technology to create, I'm using the same shapes that I found in the manuscript, to create a Nastaliq for Iran. When you try to print another language than Persian with it, you run into bizarre problems that they simply haven't bothered to design the non-Persian letters, and as a result, you get funny placebo results that cannot be used for anything. What we try to do as a concept is to parameterize these differences within one single system. So here you see an image of, on the left, Persian, on the right, Urdu. We did not make it so condensed as this handwritten ladies' magazine, but the idea is do it with a single comprehensive approach and parameterize the differences according to the regional preferences. Make them buttons, turn them on and off. And so this kind of difference is essentially the same basic typeface. It is historically the same style, used for two different languages with different regional preferences. And the solution that we came up, that we reached, was a typeface with 300, a typeface and also a font with 300 glyphs. And we've tested it some eight letters deep, continuous groups up to eight letters with everything, every basic letter shape involved, but all the variations that we have. That generated 27 billion theoretical letters. Of course, only a fraction of them are in actual use. But the question is, what's more work, to make a system that covers them all, or to figure out which ones do you need? Of course, we know that that existed in the 1970s. That's the monotype NASC. It had 20,000 ready-made letter blocks. And of course, each time a new president was chosen that wasn't covered by the letter block, they had to fill it in by hand or add a letter block. In this one, we push it many steps further, because this one doesn't handle just Persian or just Urdu, it handles them all at the same time. So it has Pashto, Kurdish. It's a matter of courtesy. All the additional the Arabic, extended Arabic letters that are in the Unicode standard are covered. Even Eastern Uzbek or Uyghur is covered. And here is an image of a specimen sheet that Titus Nemet designed for us, that shows the same typeface in use in totally different environments, where it is stretched out, spaced out, condensed, and used with different orthographies, different languages. I have focused on Nastaliq because it is a good case of a concrete wall for technology. This script needs to be served. It cannot be domesticated. This requires an effort on the part of the industry to create the technical solutions in order to keep the script intact. And it's not just, this is not the only one. We have the Ruka script, and just a quick impression, you know that we started with Ruka in the first place. When people in the Middle East, this is taken in Iraq. In fact, we require from the Iraqi government, Nutalab al-Hukuma al-Iraqiya wa ala ra'isaha Sayyid Nur al-Malik, to take measures. We demand from the Iraqi government to take measures to protect our dead from the occupying forces. So not everybody is in favor of the present situation, but the thing is, whatever their message, they use Ruka and not some kind of simplified Western design. And here is our own image for it. This is another one that needs, well, we are now working on Ruka version 2. We hope to have this ready soon, and this is our old Ruka, which was basically a mechanization of the grammar of the writing system, where the hand of the British scholar Mitchell was our guidance. And T.F. Mitchell was not an Arabist, he was a phoneticist. And this is a remark that I made earlier, that in this operation, Orientalists are remarkably absent. I need to conclude, therefore, that in order to get results, you need to concentrate on interdisciplinary work. But we were able to do this in a collaboration between an aircraft engineer and an artist and a linguist. And I think this is this is a good example. I was recently in Canada at McGill University, where we were talking about developing OCR for Ottoman script. And again, you had the same idea. Work together in different disciplines, listen to each other, get out of your cubicle, because an Arabic font cannot be designed by a font designer or by a type designer. It has to be, certainly if he doesn't know Arabic, and if he's an Arab, he usually doesn't know any of the other languages that are written with this script. And in order to get a comprehensive solution, you have to get out of your box. And I'd like to conclude here and give the floor back to the one who owns it. Oh yeah. Are there questions? I have only answers.
The underlying text structure is already still Unicode.
It's definitely Unicode. Yeah. Yeah. I've been involved in Unicode with Unicode since 1988. A clear separation between the abstract letters that you don't see but that you conceive on the one hand, the graphemes, and on the other hand, the graphic complexity or construction that you physically have to manage. I call them allographs, and I'm basing my thinking about on my education as a Slavic, in Slavic studies, where you get a big accent, a stress on phonology and phonetics and a clear difference and orthography. All these things were clearly defined and separated in a way that you don't see that in Oriental studies. Oriental studies are in this field still very much in the 19th century.
Any other questions?